Thanks very much. Talking about the future, they bring on the fusion guy. It's the this is the most ambitious experiment possibly ever. This is ITER, and we're building it in southern France. And it's an incredible piece of kit. The scale is standard European person right there, so you can see how big it is. It's surrounded by all kinds of other equipment, so it's a lot more than you can just see in this picture. The object of this experiment is for the first time to make a sustained fusion burn on Earth, controlled for thousands of seconds, hopefully, and hundreds of megawatts. The baseline case for this is half a gigawatt of power, size of a small power station, 400 seconds of burn. But we think now that we can probably exceed these figures and get to what we call ignition, which is where the plasma is completely sustained by the fusion burn inside it. And you basically turn it on, heat it up to 200 million degrees, piece of cake. And when it gets to about 150 million degrees, it'll start to fusion burn. And at that point, it'll sustain itself, and we'll be able to sort of stand back and watch the power pour. I don't know why I use two P words there, but power pour out of the plasma. The plasma in this device is contained in a ring inside very strong magnetic fields. And the reason I'm here, right, because I don't know much about superconductivity, I know a little bit about superconducting magnets, is because this thing is contained by probably the largest superconducting magnets that have ever been made. Absolutely enormous superconducting magnets producing a field in the middle of this donut-shaped hull of 5.2 tesla and right at the edge on the inside of 11.8 tesla, right next to the magnet on the inside. It's a huge magnetic field in a huge volume. And it's that magnetic field that contained a plasma at about 200 million degrees with a pressure of about 7 atmospheres in the center pushing out against the magnetic field. The pressure of the magnetic field in this is about 100 atmospheres. It's mostly balancing itself, so the residual is balancing the pressure of that plasma pushing out from the middle there. It's going to be a remarkable device, and the turn-on time is November 2019, and if you know anything about scientific projects, quoting the month is ridiculous. Quoting the year is hard enough, but quoting the month is ridiculous. Its cost is sort of undetermined at this point, but it's the wrong side of 10 billion. There are 7 international partners in this, and if you ever want to build an experiment with 7 international partners, come and talk to me first. It certainly has the advantage that we're able to tap expertise and particularly science expertise, but also technological expertise from all around the world, including Oxford Instruments. These superconducting magnets are the heart of the thing, and fusion won't actually work without superconducting magnets, at least not this approach to fusion. Why do we know? Well, no. People like me say we know. Why do we think it will achieve those parameters? This is a bit of blatant self-promotion for my laboratory, but back in the late 90s, after many years of struggling to really contain something at sufficient temperature to make fusion work, the end of the 80s and the 90s, we began to step up the temperatures and the densities in the middle of the plasma to actually get to the kind of conditions at which you can do fusion. And as we stepped up those conditions, we eventually put in the fusion fuel, which is deuterium and tritium, into the device. And in 1997 at Cullum in JET, we actually produced 16 megawatts of fusion power. Now, not for a terribly long time. This is the time across the bottom here. So it's in seconds and not hours. The fusion power is up the left-hand side. And you've always, in these more popular talks, got to show some people really enjoying themselves. And I'm told this was the moment we hit 16 megawatts, but it could well be staged at that point. Actually, this blue line, which is the dark blue line, which is the 16 megawatts, is actually not the most impressive line on there, because as you can see, it went up 16 megawatts, came down. The line which we scale up to ITER's performance, and I think we understand how it behaves and how it scales, is this line here, in which we turn the machine off on at zero. We ramped up the power, heated the plasma up to about, in this case, about 190 million degrees, sustained it throughout the shot, and closed it down at the end. Now, you can't run jet for more than about 5 seconds at full power, because it's got copper magnets. And you certainly couldn't run a fusion device with copper magnets, because you're pouring in the little thing that we never tell you, is that this time we were pouring in about 15 megawatts, 18 megawatts of power to sustain it at that level into the plasma. But we were also pouring power into the copper magnets to drive the current around it. And with current scalings, it's very difficult to see how we would actually get to net power if we had to push the current around copper magnets. What are we doing in the center there? For those of you who don't know much about fusion, I'll give you a little fusion primer. Close enough, the strong force binds them together, makes for an instant helium 5 in the 3/2 state, as it turns out, and it spits out helium 4 and a neutron. And with it, lots of energy in the form of the kinetic energy of those particles. The neutron you have to arrange to hit some lithium to breed yourself some tritium that you then put back into the reaction. And that's the reaction everybody wants to do, because it's 100 times easier than any other fusion reaction can do. There are lots of people out there claiming to do more exotic fusion. If they can't do this one, they can't do exotic fusion either. So this is the reaction. And typically inside something at about 150, 200 million degrees, typical interaction between deuterium and tritium looks like that. They just bounce off each other. That's an elastic collision. And because they repel, they bounce off each other. If you get them lined up and they're moving fast enough, every now and again they will hit each other and they will fuse and they will produce those particles. And that's what we're after, because if they do, they'll heat the plasma, they'll sustain the plasma, and the energy will come out as those neutrons, and we can power, you know, power stations with it. Just a little note about how much fusion power there is. In seawater, there's enough lithium for 30 million years of powering the world entirely by fusion. So it's a magnificent way to do energy, but except one thing, it's really, really hard. And at the heart of everything is a coil. It's a coil that has to push in on the plasma, hold the thing that's at 200 million degrees off the wall so it doesn't melt the wall, and hold it there steady for hours, days at a time. It'll have to be a superconducting coil. So right from Martin's first superconducting coil in 1962 to the ITER coils, these things stand, it's about 12 meters tall, like the exact height depends from where you measure there. It's about 12 meters tall, about 6 meters across. It contains tons of niobium tin, which is the superconducting strand, some of it made by Oxford Instruments for the toroidal field coils on ITER. It has to be cooled to 4 degrees Kelvin. So in the middle of this system, you've got something at 200 million degrees, and you've got right next to it something at 4 degrees Kelvin, cooled by liquid helium that flows through it. it provides this immense magnetic pressure that holds less than a gram of deuterium and tritium inside the machine as it is raised in temperature until it produces that pressure of 7 atmosphere. It's got many coils. It's not just those ones round there. You've also got coils that shape it and control it and the plasma, and it's got a solenoid down the middle, all of it made from superconductors. Right? It's a magnificent piece of superconducting engineering. If you take the coil system on ITER and you ask how much energy do we have to put in to sustain this large volume full of magnetic field, it sounds like a lot of energy. It's about 30 megawatts of power necessary to cool the coils and keep them cool. We don't have to put any energy to sustain the electricity in them. It's just to keep them cool. It's about 30 megawatts of power. And one of the key things here is that the fusion is making neutrons. They come out of the plasma, and the shielding is quite good, but even so, some neutrons get inside the superconductor, produce some heat, and you've got to pump that heat away. So all of that means you have to spend about 30 megawatts of power in order to do that. But you're making 500 megawatts of fusion power, so it's not a bad ratio of recycling power. If we made it of copper magnets, it will take about 500 to 600 megawatts of power just to push the electricity around, actually. I didn't calculate the cooling power on that, too. So it's clearly just impossible to do this without superconductors. And if we're going to go to a fusion economy in the future where fusion may provide, 50% of the electricity in the developed world or something like that, perhaps in the second half of this century, we're going to have an awful lot of superconducting magnets and an awful lot of superconducting strand produced by Oxford Instruments. The question is, can you do better than we're currently doing? What is the future of superconducting magnets? Will they become better than these ones? These are niobium tin. It's quite for the connections to the outside world. Because you've got to connect to something that's at 4 degrees Kelvin, and you've got to connect that to the outside world, and you don't want a hot connection. So one of the ways of doing this is to use high-temperature superconductors as the intermediary between the outside and the inside, and therefore you don't have any ohmic dissipation in your connector on the way. And so this is using bismuth, strontium, calcium, copper oxide, B2223 for the experts in the room, is the connectors. And these are being made, these leads are actually being made in China at the moment, but some of the leads for some of the other devices are being made in Germany. What would be a better... How could superconductivity make fusion come quicker? You've all heard the joke about fusion being 50 years away and always will be. I sincerely think that it won't be. It will be here. But it would be much better if we could make stronger magnetic fields at higher temperatures rather than 4 degrees Kelvin. The fusion power, the power that comes out of the machine, scales like the magnetic field to the fourth power. Double the magnetic field, and you get 16 times as much power coming out of the fusion device. So if we could go from 5 Tesla to 10 Tesla, right, then the power out of ITER would be 8 gigawatts. Right? It would be a fantastic machine. So if you can produce me superconducting coils, right, that 10 Tesla, of maybe not quite as big as that, because if we got 10 Tesla, we could make a smaller device. Right, we could make much more efficient fusion. And we would like it at high temperatures, too. I mean, I know I'm asking for something that doesn't exist, but it would be very helpful, and hopefully in the future we'll approach these numbers. Smaller, more efficient fusion reactors would be a godsend. We're hoping to get the first fusion electricity by 2040. This is a picture. Well... by 2040, probably the machine by 2040 and the electricity sometime in the 2040s. This is the current roadmap of the European Fusion Program, and this is a picture of what that machine would be like. It would deliver, this I think is 1.3 gigawatts electrical, so over 3 gigawatts of fusion power pouring out of it. Not much bigger than ITER, but much more powerful. A denser plasma, slightly higher magnetic field, etc. The idea is to get a machine online, actually produce some electricity, and really look the future in the face, as it were. A better life through superconductivity. It's not a better life through chemicals. It's pretty certain we can do fusion. But what's not certain to the fusion community, and certainly not to people outside the fusion community, if we can do it at a cost and scale that the market wants. And a key to that will probably be what we can do with superconducting magnets. That picture of the conceptual design of a fusion reactor, 40% of the cost was the superconducting magnet system. If you can reduce that cost and make them better...